Welcome back, children. In the last class, we had seen how the Tiger King was on the verge of losing his kingdom due to his aim of killing 100 tigers, and how he came out of the situation by bribing the wife of the British official. And please do not forget, the background is British India. Today we are going to start with page 12, part 4 of this lesson. The Maharaja's tiger hunt continued to be highly successful. So the Maharaja started with his, after all the problems that he had faced with his kingdom, he overcame that, and then his tiger hunting schedule and his tiger hunting down tigers went on successfully. That is, he hunted down many tigers. Within 10 years, he was able to kill 70 tigers. So within 10 years, that is, maybe each year he used to kill around 7 tigers. So within 10 years, he could complete his aim. He was coming closer to his aim of killing 70 tigers. And then, as an unforeseen hurdle brought his mission to a standstill. So suddenly, what happened? Nobody had imagined that such a hurdle means a stop would come, or a barrier would come to, in between his mission and him. Okay, so his mission was to kill 100 tigers. So he has killed 70. Now he has to kill 30 more tigers. But then some hurdle or a barrier came between his aim and him. Let's see what the barrier is, or the hurdle is. The tiger population became extinct in the forests of Pratibandhapuram. Now this was a big problem. Due to continuous hunting of tigers, the tiger population became extinct. That is, there were no more tigers left in the forest of Pratibandhapuram. Now, what to do? That was the next question. Who knows whether the tigers practiced birth control or committed harakiri? So, there was no... there were many... assumptions why this population, tiger population, had come to a verge of extinct or had extincted. So the first thing was that whether these tigers practiced birth control measures like human beings, or maybe committed harakiri. Harakiri is in some animals, actually, when their population goes above control, there is a mass destruction among the animals. It's known as harakiri. Harakiri actually is a martial technique used in China. So, but then among animals also, mass suicide, it's known as. Mass suicide is also seen in some animals, not in all the animals. In some animals, such a particular concept is there. Okay. So, maybe these animals might have started with birth control measures or committed harakiri, or simply ran away from the state because they desired to be shot by the British hands alone. Or maybe they might have run away from the British from Pratibandhapuram because they never wanted to be hunted down by an Indian king. They wanted to be killed by the whites. Maybe that is the reason. Okay, these are the concepts that came into the minds of the king. But then the ultimate thing was there were no more tigers left in the kingdom, in the forest of Pratibandhapuram. That was the ultimate thing. One day the Maharaja sent for the Diwan. So one day he called Diwan. Now the question was, how will he complete his 100 mark? Okay, he has completed 70. Now he has to hunt down 30 more. What is he going to do next? So he called his Diwan. I told you, Diwan, in the modern context, it's like the manager, okay? So he called his Diwan. Diwan Sahib, aren't you aware of the fact that 30 tigers still remain to be shot by this gun of mine? He asked, brandishing his gun. So king called the Diwan and he asked him, don't you remember that there are 30 more tigers to be killed by this gun of mine? And he pointed the gun towards the divan and he was like aiming it. Okay, so the divan, shuddering at the sight of the gun, the divan cried out, "Your Majesty, I'm not a tiger." So when he saw that, he felt that the divan and this king was totally annoyed or angry or irritated because he has to kill 30 more tigers. Now it's his turn to be killed because the king could not complete his or was unable to complete his mission. So when he sees, he shivers. He just shivers, shuddering, shivered at the sight of the gun and said, "Your Majesty, don't shoot me. I'm not a tiger." "Which idiot would call you a tiger?" So he says, so the king says, "Which idiot? Who will call you? Who is such an idiot who will call you a tiger?" "No, and I'm not a gun." So actually here a comical element has come in, humorous concept has come in, only because he wants to make the concept maybe a little lighter. So here we can see when he says that, when the Divan says that, "I'm not a gun," that shows that he is totally out of his senses seeing the gun. He feels that today is the end of me. That's what the Divan feels. So here the author has brought in a little comical element to give you a little entertainment maybe in between. "You are neither a tiger nor a gun, Divan Sahib. I summoned you here for a different purpose. I have decided to get married." So the king says, okay, calm down. You are neither a tiger nor a gun. I've called you here because now I have decided to get married and I want some proposals. So the Divan could not get the point. So he says, the Divan began to babble even more. "Your Majesty, I have two wives already. If I marry you..." So the Divan thought he was... I told you, he loses his senses just at the sight of the gun. So he just thinks, he says, okay, I'm already married to two ladies. I've got two wives and I cannot marry you. How can I marry you? So that is the ultimate thing, because the king says, "I called you because I've decided to get married." So he takes it the other way around. Okay, so as I told you, a comical element. "Your Majesty, please think it over. Your ancestors were married..." Sorry, I left a line. "Don't talk nonsense. Why should I get married? Why should I marry you? What I want is a tiger." So he says, "Why should I marry you? Are you out of your senses? Okay. The only thing I want is a tiger." Now the next thing is, is the king going to get married to a tiger? That was the next question in Divan's mind. So see how he presents it. "Your Majesty, please think it over. Think over before you get married. Your ancestors were married to the sword." Married to the sword means they were dedicated to the sword. That is, to the loyal to the kingdom. "And if you like, marry the gun. And as your ancestors were married to the sword, you can marry the gun. A tiger king is more than enough for the state. It doesn't need a tiger queen as well." So we already have a tiger king, but we don't need a tiger queen. So why do you want to marry a tiger? Okay, think about it second time. So this is what Divan says. Now the king means he loses his what attitude of the king and all those things, haughty nature, and he starts laughing loudly. Okay, the Maharaja gave a loud crack of laughter. "I'm not thinking of marrying either a tiger or a gun, but a girl from a rank of human beings." So Maharaja laughs loudly and he says, "Oh, you stupid, I'm not thinking of marrying a tiger or a gun or anything of that sort. I have decided to marry a girl from among human beings." Okay, but now, when we go with marriage proposals to many houses, be it girls or boys, whatever it is, we have many concepts in our mind. So here, the king, the proposal goes with not the concepts that we have. Like first, a family background, then financial status, then the job, then beauty, all these concepts come in. But here, for the Maharaja, the ultimate things, remember, he associates his marriage with his aim. Okay, so he goes, he tells, he asks the Diwan to find out the statistics of the tiger population in different kingdoms. And the kingdom that has more population of tigers, find out whether there is any princess who is about to get married, so that he can go and marry that girl and then hunt down the tiger in that kingdom too. So that was the ultimate aim that the king had. So first, you may draw up statistics of tiger populations in the different native states. So different native states in different kingdoms, you go and find out the statistics of tiger population. Next, you may investigate if there is a girl I can marry in the royal family of a state with a large tiger population. So the next thing that you have to find out is, if the population, there is a lot of tiger population in any kingdom, find out if there is any girl in that kingdom or any princess in that kingdom who is ready to marry. Okay, so that I can marry that girl. The Diwan followed his orders. He found the right girl from the state which possessed a large number of tigers. At last, the Diwan found out a girl, a right princess, whose kingdom had large population of tigers. The Maharaja Jang Jang Bahadur killed 5 or 6 tigers each time he visited his father-in-law. So each time he went to visit his father-in-law, he killed 5 to 6 tigers at one go. Okay, in this manner he killed 99 tigers. Okay, in this manner he killed 99 tigers. So remember what astrologer said, that you might kill 99 tigers in the same way, but beware of the 100th. So 99, the concept of 99 has been reached. Now let's see. In this manner, 99 tiger skins adorned the walls of the reception hall in the Pratibandhapuram palace. So adorned means decorated. So the Pratibandhapuram palace hall, okay, reception hall was decorated with 99 tiger skins. That showed how brave the king is. Another thing. Okay, so now we are moving on to the next 100 tiger. So next day we'll see what he does, or how he goes about killing the 100th tiger. Okay, and whether he is able to hunt down the 100th tiger, or does he face any other problem on his way hunting the 100th tiger. Okay, children, with this we stop here. Thank you. Have a good day.